And welcome to the Dr. Bob Show. Have you ever been bothered with nasal stuffiness? Most people, if they get a common cold, they can't breathe through their nose. They get nasal stuffiness and congestion. Some people have stuffy nose and congestion all the time. Why is that? And what can be done for a stuffy nose for nasal obstruction? You'll be surprised at the number of different causes of that problem. My guest is Dr. Nick Pinella. Dr. Pinella is a board-certified ear, nose, and throat surgeon, and he'll be talking with us about the causes of nasal obstruction and what can be done for those. Hello, I'm Dr. Robert Overholt. I'll be your host for the next 30 minutes on the Dr. Bob Show. Later on, we'll be talking about a thyroid condition, much more common in women, causes the thyroid to be inactive, causes fatigue and tiredness. What causes that? And arthritis. Why are there different types of arthritis? What are those different types? What can be done for them? A lot of information for you. You'll want to stay tuned. We're talking with Dr. Nick Pinella, board-certified ear, nose, and throat surgeon, and we're talking about nasal obstruction, a simple blocked nose. Not simple, causes lots of problems. Nick, welcome to the Dr. Bob Show.
Thanks for having me, Bob. Happy to be here.
When a patient comes in the office and says, my nose is blocked, I can't breathe through my nose, what goes through your mind?
So it's interesting. I think people sometimes have trouble with the language associated with nasal obstruction. So a lot of times people come in and they tell me, I have a sinus problem. I've had bad sinuses for years. It's a very common complaint to us. And so the first thing that I want to do when somebody comes in with sinus problems is differentiate. Are they truly having chronic sinusitis, which is not really what we're talking about today, but that's where you have recurrent infection, you're needing antibiotics, you have pain in your face, pain in your eyes, drainage. Those people probably benefit from some kind of therapy for infection, whether it be antibiotics or eventually some sort of a sinus surgery. That's what I want to differentiate between that and somebody that truly just has nasal obstruction. They can't breathe out of their nose. They say, I fall asleep at night and my mouth gapes open. I'm breathing through my mouth all the time and I'm just frustrated because I'm tired of not being able to breathe through my nose.
Is it usually one-sided obstruction or is it usually both at the same time or everybody's different?
Everybody's different, but it's one of the first things that I'm thinking of when I see a patient. I want to know the answer to that question. Some people will say, hey, I got hit in the nose with a softball when I was 15, and ever since then I can't breathe through the left side of my nose at all. That patient is probably going to need a different treatment than the patient that tells me during the day I can breathe just fine, and then at night when I lay to the left, I can't breathe on the right. When I lay on the right, I can't breathe through the left. So those patients probably have a different type of problem, and it's important to distinguish between those two kind of right off the bat when we're thinking about nasal airway obstruction.
So do you think about it by taking the history or history plus physical? What do you find when you look at the nose when somebody's got one of those histories?
So they're both important. I want to make sure that I have a pretty good idea of what's going on before we start looking, because sometimes we might want to do something like a CT scan to look for sinusitis. Sometimes we won't need to do that. Most of the time with somebody that can't breathe through their nose, it's something that we can figure out with the history, knowing do they have allergies, are you sneezing a lot, are your eyes itching? That's one group. Are you somebody that's had a nasal trauma? That's a separate group. So the history is really, really important when we're building our foundation of what might be causing this obstruction. And then looking in the nose after that.
When somebody's talking with you, do you automatically start looking at their nose and looking at their eyes? What tip-offs do you see of somebody that's got nasal obstruction?
Sure. So there are some things, particularly in kids or people that have had nasal obstruction since development, sometimes we can see differences in the face shape because chronic mouth breathing is not the way that our bodies like to breathe. And so there's some changes that take place. But primarily, this is kind of a hidden problem, which is one of the unique things about it. So when I see somebody, they may have the worst deviated septum in the world, but you don't know at all just by looking at them. And same thing with the turbinates. Those are structures that are all pretty well encased in our nose. And so when you look in and you're kind of looking at them in the clinic, you can't see a lot most of the time.
So let's talk about the anatomy of the nose just a little bit.
Sure.
We've got a septum. Is that the septum is where in the nose?
So I've got a little diagram because I use this constantly when I'm talking to people in the clinic about it. So the septum is the area in the middle of the nose. It's what divides the left and the right. It's primarily cartilage, but there's a little thin piece of bone that's involved too. So the septum is what divides the two sides. A deviated septum is when that thing has become very crooked, often from trauma.
Does it usually go to one side or the other? Is it usually right-sided or left-sided?
It depends on the injury. It depends on what caused it. Sometimes it's just like a V. It goes over to one side and back, and it will block one side completely. Sometimes it's more S-shaped, so it'll manage to block both sides as it curves backwards and into each side.
When you examine the nose, can you see which way the septum's going?
You can. So one of the things that we use when we're evaluating the nose is a very old, tried and true piece of equipment. This is a nasal speculum. If you ever see somebody using it, it's not a painful thing. It looks kind of funny and sometimes is intimidating. But what I do is I use this to lift up the soft tissues of the nose so that I can see inside, see the septum, see the turbinates, and get a good idea without having to do anything invasive, just a headlight and a nasal speculum.
Now, you mentioned the word turbinates. What are the turbinates inside the nose? What are they? We've got the septum is in the middle. We've got a hole we breathe through on both sides. What are the turbinates?
The turbinates are these little comma-shaped things that come off the side of the nose. These are normal structures. They're part of our conditioning unit for the air that comes into our lungs. So they're going to warm the air up. When it's cool outside, they're going to moisturize the air, and they're going to be one of the first thing that filters the allergens in the air as it comes into our bodies. So we all have turbinates. We need our turbinates. The problem becomes when the turbinates become too big, they can really block the nose.
So what can make the turbinates become big? Allergies?
Absolutely.
Irritation,
you know that one
pollution.
Well. Allergies is probably in this area the most common cause. So that's whether it's, you know, somebody that's had allergies their entire life or somebody that just the cumulative effect of the things that are in the environment have finally built up and over time they finally get blocked. Allergies is a major cause. Trauma can cause that. And then some people are just born with really big turbinates, just bigger than average, just kind of too big for their body. And those can really take up a lot of space.
So we've talked about space occupying, the turbinates, a crooked nose, it makes the airflow different. How about the outside cartilage of the nose? Now, this part is cartilage or bone, the front part?
So this part's bone, and this is the part that people think of when they say, I broke my nose, is usually if they broke their nasal bones. This lower part of the nose is cartilage. It's just a cartilage framework with skin draped on top of it. So when we're looking at a nose and we see, oh, the septum doesn't look too bad, the turbinates don't look too bad, one of the next places we like to look is at these cartilages here, because sometimes there's kind of two separate problems we see. Sometimes these cartilages are just too weak. So every time you take a breath in, they collapse. And when they collapse, it feels like you've got a valve that's being closed. The other problem is sometimes they're just too narrow. And that can be from birth or from trauma, just the way that you look. Sometimes people just have these narrow areas, and those narrow areas shut off the air that's trying to come into the nose.
So is it that type problem that maybe breathe right strips open up the nose? Well, that's because the cartilage. So we've got cartilage, we've got a septum that can be crooked, we've got turbinates in there that can be enlarged. Can you visualize all of those when somebody comes into your office and says, I can't breathe through my nose, doc?
We can, and that's one of the cool things about this problem is it does not require invasive imaging, usually does not require a camera or an endoscope to be used in there. Really what we're doing is just looking at the nose. Like I said, headlight and a nasal speculum, I can really evaluate those three most common causes of nasal obstruction. Now there's some other ones, some oddities out there, but those are the most common causes. And with each of those, you can really get a good look just looking in the front with a speculum.
So when you find out what the problem is, deviated septum, enlarged turbinates, or the cartilage that's sort of weak on the outside, are those fixable?
They are. They are. Each of those is fixable in their own way.
And that's what we're going to be talking about when we come back. Each one of those are fixable in their whole way. So how do you fix a crooked septum? How do you correct turbinates that are enlarged? How do you make the cartilage firmer or stronger where it doesn't collapse when you try and breathe? We'll have that information when we come back. We're talking with Dr. Nick Pannella, board-certified ear, nose, and throat doctor. We've been talking about nasal obstruction. We've been talking about a crooked nose. We've been talking about enlarged turbinates inside the nose. And we've talked about a weak outside of the nose, all of which can be fixed. Nick, let's talk about the crooked nose, septal deviation. What do you do for that? How do you know how bad it is? And how do you know how to attack it?
So septal deviation is one of the areas where the nose can be blocked that we've got a really, really tried and true algorithm. It's one of the most common surgeries that's done in ENT. Usually what we do is when we see a patient that's got a bad septal deviation, you can identify it right away. You can identify their problem. They can tell you, hey, my left side's bad. Oftentimes they have a trauma history, although not always a bad one. You know, it's not always a boxer. Oftentimes it's just somebody that they're, you know, one of their kids when they were growing up bonked them in the nose playing or something. And so the septum is cartilage, so it's pretty easy to break. And so we look in, we see it, and we say, hey, I think a surgery would be the most helpful thing for you here. There's not really a great way to address the septum without trying to straighten it.
So how do you straighten out the septum since you've got bone up on the top and you've got cartilage in the middle? What do?
So you go in through the nose, there's no cuts on the outside of the face, no one can tell you've had the surgery. We traditionally do these asleep, although there are some people that prefer to do them awake with local anesthesia, which is an option. But you make a little cut on the lining of the nose, you lift the lining up until you can see the cartilage, and then you can strategically look and see, okay, here's a bend here and a bend here. You take out the bend parts, sometimes you can straighten pieces and put it back in, or sometimes you just leave kind of the framework behind. As long as you leave a little bit of support, the nose will behave just normally, even without the deviated parts.
So when you do that correction, which sounds so simple, and I know it's not simple that, what kind of results do you get?
So septoplasty is a very effective intervention, very low risk and very high rate of success. So 90% or greater of patients will have a significant demonstrable effect or improvement in their nasal breathing.
So if somebody's got a crooked nose, we can fix that. How about the turbinates inside the nose? There's these three little mountains on each side
that
are turbinates, and they provide a surface area to warm the air as we breathe, to humidify the air, and filter out some things. Now, what do you do if a turbinate is too large?
So usually we want to make sure we've talked about allergy therapy, whether that be, you know, a nasal steroid or a nasal antihistamine, an over-the-counter oral antihistamine, maybe even allergy shots. We want to make sure we've talked a lot about allergy because that's a common cause. And oftentimes when somebody comes to see me thinking that they're going to end up needing nasal surgery, it's as simple as controlling their allergies with medical interventions. And so sometimes we don't need to do anything for the turbinates. But when we fail those interventions, when somebody continues to have symptoms, then we talk about, okay, what needs to be done next? And then we talk about structural changes. So the turbinates are actually filled with blood. That's what allows them to swell. And so the turbinates, the structure, the bony structure, doesn't usually need to be messed with. What we're trying to do is reduce their ability to swell. And this is something that we most often, when we're doing just a turbinate surgery, we most often do this in the office, awake with local anesthesia, meaning topical numbing medicine.
So you spray the nose with topical numbing medicine. You know where the turbinate is. Well, what do you do to it? Do you squeeze it? Do you tear it out? What do you do?
So use a small camera so that you can see inside of the nose and traumatize the tissue as little as possible. And then there's two primary techniques. One is a little needle that heats up with radio frequency energy, and it just from the inside out more or less cooks away that tissue. The other is an instrument that goes in and physically removes that little matrix of blood vessels. So it kind of smooths it out. And both of those give the body less of an opportunity to be able to swell and fill the nose up.
So when you use the little needle in there and you heat it and it causes some trauma there, swells at first and then scars down?
Correct.
Good results with that?
Excellent results. Both the techniques have very similar results. Different surgeons have different preferences, but both of them are really good ways to improve the nasal airway in somebody that's been identified correctly as having turbinates as their primary problem.
So you can see these turbinates by x-ray. You get a CT scan, you can tell what the turbinates are doing, and you can see them by physical exam.
Correct.
So you should be able to get a pretty good idea of what you're working with. Can you decide how much you need to shrink it? Because some are larger than the others.
That comes with experience and with doing this a lot and with thinking about kind of that patient how's their nose, how narrow is the actual opening of the nose, how long has this problem been going on? And so, yeah, it's a little bit of a judgment call, but usually we can make the right judgment and get people good improvement without the danger of resecting too much or removing too much of the turbinate is that the nose can get overly dry. And so that's the thing we're trying to avoid.
So somebody can have a crooked nose and a turbinate that needs to be reduced in size both at the same time. Let's talk about the collapse of the outside of the nose, because that can be a real problem.
It can, and it's been an interesting thing because we didn't talk about nasal valve collapse that much before the last couple of years where we have some new interventions. The nasal valves are primarily made of cartilage. It's a thin cartilage, and they're hard to fix, or they had been, short of something called a rhinoplasty. That's the surgery that you see on TV that celebrities might have to make their nose more cosmetically appealing. But there's also a group of a different subset of those surgeries that are done just for functional reasons. So a functional rhinoplasty is a surgery that can be done to strengthen the cartilage, to widen parts of the nose that are narrow, and improve the flow of air through the nose.
So what do you do?
So a rhinoplasty actually involves incisions either under the nose or inside of the nose. The skin of the nose is lifted up and the cartilage can be reconstructed or recreated, sometimes breaking the bones as well. So it's a pretty involved operation. For some people, it's absolutely the right way to go, but for a lot of people, they'd say, well, you know, I've got this stuffy nose, it bothers me, it's not particularly painful, it's not a life-threatening problem, it's not ruining my life, so maybe I don't want to go with that more involved intervention, and maybe they shy away from the idea of a rhinoplasty for it.
How about somebody that just, you know, if I pull my nose out like this, I can breathe better. It's called a caudal maneuver, I think. But if that happens and it's spreading out the nose, what do? Do you insert something in there?
So those people now we have a great intervention for, because we say, well, again, you may not want to do the rhinoplasty for this, but now we've got a couple of things that might really, really change your symptoms without having to undergo a major operation. So one of the ways that we do that now is with a little inserted piece of dissolvable plastic. This is called a Latera implant. And what this is it's the same type of plastic that we make our absorbable sutures out of. And it goes in right next to the cartilages and it provides a little cantilever or support beam. So when you breathe in, this doesn't allow the cartilage to collapse in. And so this is a neat little intervention. It can be done in the operating room or it can be done in the clinic with local numbing medicine so that you can really support the lateral wall so that when you take a deep breath in, the nose doesn't squish shut. That's exactly
right. So it looks to me like what I'm hearing is most all problems that we have that cause nasal obstruction can be fixed and can be fixed reasonably easy. I want to talk about one other thing before we close out. There are some people that get a stuffy nose every time they eat food. We call it after eating swollen nose, post-gustatory rhinitis. And it's very common. You go out and you eat a meal and you start getting a runny nose and congestion. You have to go blow your nose. What's going on at that time and what can we do to help that?
So when people are having that problem and we say, hey, you know, are you sure it's not allergy? Usually that person has tried an allergy medicine, but when it's really just the meals or temperature change that's triggering it, we call that vasomotor rhinitis. That's a nerve that has gotten overly excited. And when that nerve is overly excited, it's sending the signal to the glands, the mucus glands inside of the nose, and it's stimulating them at the wrong time. We see that more as people age, and we can see pretty significant problems there. So one of the things that we can do now is we have a device that can go into the nose, and it actually acts to freeze that nerve. So this slips into the nose, actually past those turbinates that we were talking about, and this gets to a very cold temperature, freezes the nerve so that the signal won't be transmitted as strong across the nerve.
How long does that last?
Permanent.
Permanent.
It's a pretty cooled intervention. Now, it is a newer device. I can't say that people have had it and had it done for 30 or 40 years, but the long-term research that we have so far is very, very encouraging for this being a permanent intervention for people. So,
you know, the nose, and sometimes I say you can have a lemon for a nose or a rose for a nose. The nose can certainly cause a lot of problems. And what I'm hearing is there's so much that the ENT physician can do to help people that can't breathe through their nose. Nick Pinelli, you're a great teacher. Thank you for coming to the Dr. Bob Show. I've been excited about this show, and I think a lot of information for me.
Thank you. I'm very happy to be here. Thanks.
Great, great information. You're going to want to stay tuned. We're going to be talking about a thyroid condition, Hashimoto's disease, struma lymphomatosa, pretty much more common than you think it is, and also different types of arthritis. What's going on and what can we do to help those people? A lot of information. You're going to want to stay tuned. I want to thank Dr. Nick Pinella. Wonderful discussion on nasal obstruction. So much that we can do for such a big problem. And now questions from you, the viewer, that I think will be important to your health. Dr. Bob, question number one. What is Hashimoto's disease? Well, it sounds like that's a question of stump the stars, but it's a very common problem. And Hashimoto's disease, it's got another name, struma lymphomatosa, but what this is an autoimmune disease where the body begins to attack its own thyroid gland. Let's talk about the thyroid gland. It's a little butterfly gland in the neck. It produces hormones, thyroid hormones, that go to the cells and cause metabolism. If there's not enough thyroid hormone, the pituitary gland in the brain throws out some TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone. The thyroid is stimulated, it produces the hormone, and we stay in good balance so that our body and our cells will have proper metabolism. Now, if there's an autoimmune problem that begins to attack the thyroid gland, there are cells called lymphocytes that begin to take over the thyroid gland and make it where it doesn't function well. It will not put out enough thyroid hormone. When that happens, it's easy to replace the thyroid hormone. Sometimes that thyroid gland will get enlarged and it needs to be removed. Sometimes you just need to replace with thyroid hormone. That's guided by a TSH. If there is a lot of TSH and low amount of thyroid hormone, you just need to give more thyroid hormone. It's easy to balance the two, but it's very, very important that they're balanced properly so that your body's metabolism will be able to work properly. Question number two, Dr. Bob, why do people get arthritis? Well, that is really a good question. And we're too stupid in medicine to know why people get arthritis. We know what arthritis is. We know what's going on with arthritis. But we really don't know why people get arthritis. There are different types of arthritis. One is called osteoarthritis. That's more of a wear and tear where the joints just have been worked too much and they wear out and they get painful and they get swollen. That's osteoarthritis. We get that in the hips, we get that in the knees, we get in the ankles, and we can get that in the fingers. The other is rheumatoid arthritis. And this is a different type of arthritis where the lining of the joints is called the synovium. It becomes inflamed, and when it becomes inflamed, it makes a very sore and very stiff joints. They're usually worse in the morning. They usually get better with activity. Heat will usually make them better. Sometimes anti-inflammatory medicines will help. Sometimes there are different mixed types of arthritis. Psoriasis causes an arthritis that attacks the synovium. People with gouty arthritis. In the synovium, the lining of the joints, there's deposition of uric acid crystals. And uric acid that floats around the bloodstream gets inside the joints and sets up a very painful inflammation. Very common in the joint of the big toe. It's called podalgia. And usually the uric acid level is elevated. We have to bring it down with some medications. And for an acute attack of gouty arthritis, there are some medicines that we can take to relieve the severe pain that goes. So arthritis has different types. The treatment usually is similar. You treat medicines to cut down on the pain and the swelling, whether it's the synovium or in the joint itself that's being destroyed. Will depend on what kind of treatment your doctor plans for you. All the time that we have for this show, four things that we like on the Dr. Bob Show. Number one, exercise. We don't spend enough time exercising. We should be doing that 5, 6, 7 days a week. It should be continuous activity, brisk walking, swimming, working in the garden, anything that puts out continuous activity. And we need to be sure that that's part of our lifestyle. So we need to find a time of the day, either early in the morning or after we come home from work, where we can go out for a walk, we get our tennis shoes out. And it's great if you find somebody to meet, so you'll be exercising. Cuts down on stress, helps us lose weight, lowers our blood pressure, does so many good things. We want to get 7.5 hours sleep. It's very simple. You simply count down when you want to wake up, and you should wake up at the same time. You should go to bed at the same time. If there's something that's preventing you from sleeping properly, you need to recognize that. Is it pain in shoulders? Is it medicines that you're taking that attack the brain and make the brain want to stay awake and not go to sleep? Is there extra noise? Is there? Are you having nasal obstruction? Are you snoring? Is the person next to you snoring? Eat properly. You know, we all know the kind of foods we should eat, but eat proper foods and eat them well. And most of all, what is it we like? It's laughter in your life. Laugh a lot and you'll find out that you'll stay healthier, happier, and so will the people around you.